A warm welcome from Snamalloys Private Limited, and it is a privilege again to join with Dynamic Foundry Group to meet our beloved foundry customers for sharing our knowledge with the experience we have gained over years. And today's presentation, we'll be discussing about effect of magnesium percentage and size distribution of nodulizers in the production of ductile iron. Hope everybody are safe and healthy. So today we'll be discussing about what is ductile iron, what is the role of magnesium as nodulizer in ductile iron, effect of residual magnesium in ductile iron, and magnesium percentage in the nodulizer in the ductile iron, and factors which influence and affect the magnesium recovery, and selection of magnesium percentage in nodulizer based on the process parameters and melt conditions, and effect of size distribution of nodulizers in ductile iron, and some theoretical calculations behind it, and the factors influencing the selection of nodulizer size distribution. So we all know that ductile iron is also called as ductile cast iron or spheroidal graphite iron or nodular cast iron because it contains graphite in the shape of nodules or spheroids or round three-dimensionally, and it was accidentally invented by Keith Mills in the year 1943. And as this type of cast iron contains graphite in the form of round nodules, it provides good ductility, increased toughness and fracture resistance, and the same way it gives better strength when compared to the conventional flake graphite iron. And also when we compare ductile and then tensile strength equivalence with malleable iron and steel castings, ductile iron is cost competitive to achieve or to produce casting with a similar strength and then ductility as a replacement for malleable iron or steel castings. So the precipitation of round nodules in the graphite in the form of round nodules help in countering the solidification or contraction happening during volumetric contraction happening during solidification. And hence shrinkage kind of defects will get avoided or eliminated by the graphite precipitation and growth. So when we come and discuss about nodulizers, nodulizers are either pure elements or alloy or compounds which when added to ductile iron help in converting the morphology of graphite precipitating into round or spheroids. So without a nodulizer, there has been no ductile iron production being evidenced so far. So you definitely need a nodulizer in any form to produce ductile iron. There are different types of nodulizers available. So magnesium, the most common and the most potent nodulizer known so far. Pure magnesium by itself is a nodulizing element or nodulizer. And there are alloys of magnesium available commercially, which is classified into heavy master alloys and light master alloys. Heavy master alloys contain heavy elements like nickel and copper. So the magnesium alloy contains nickel and copper in it. Since it is heavy metal, so it is called as heavy master alloys. Light master alloys are generally based upon ferrosilicon materials. So it contains iron, silicon, magnesium and other constituents. So all these three nodulizing elements or nodulizers are being used in different forms in foundry industry based on their process and application. So there are lumps forms being used, there are granular forms of the above three materials being used, and there is a technology called cold wave technology where these either of these three materials are stuck inside a wire and then being injected into the metal or plunged into the metal. And there are pressed powders available like in the form of a pellet or something which is being added to the ductile iron treatment ladle, and then ductile iron treatment is happening. So as there are three different types of nodulizers available, this table talks about the comparison of three different types of nodulizers against the requirements or general expectations of a foundry, like a reaction violence, because every ductile iron treatment is associated with a highly violent reaction because of the magnesium present. And as there is violence and there is going to be a quantification of or the beneficial effect out of magnesium from the ductile iron treatment is going to be a magnesium recovery. And this is determining the amount of ferrosilicon magnesium or magnesium alloy to be added further. And it also talks about the process capability and then efficiency. And people expect or people or foundry people expect or the alloy is supposed to provide some inoculation effect also, and it also has some effect on the general inoculation, overall inoculation. So the alloy or material or element by itself can provide inoculation effect, or it can demand for inoculation, like the inoculation requirement after this treatment, and slag formation, because the elements present in an alloy or the magnesium element separately is a draws or slag forming element. So the amount of slag generated from either of these three from these three nodulizing materials are compared, and the cost. Cost comes into picture when we quantify the amount of material required to achieve the optimum or desired magnesium recovery to meet the required properties of the casting. So in that case, if we see there are a lot of greens available in light master alloy. So the green ones indicate the most preferred ones, yellow ones are the medium, average, and the red ones are not desired. So in that case, light master alloys have got a bigger advantage over the other two type of nodulizers. So a lot of greens in most of the desired parameters from foundry. Generally, light master alloy. So the entire presentation will be discussing about light master alloy. Light master alloy is a ferrosilicon based metal, as discussed previously. So it will contain one or major of the following elements, like magnesium, which is the primary nodulizing element, silicon, which is the carrier element, calcium is a supporting element, rare earths are again supporting elements. Rare earths include cerium, lanthanum, and other rare earth elements like praseodymium and neodymium in small amounts. So these elements form different varieties at different addition rates, and different ingredients at different ratios form different grades of nodulizers, and these are being picked and used based upon the application and requirements of foundry. So when we talk about the basic properties of magnesium falls under alkaline earth metals group 2s block element, with a melting point of 650 degrees Celsius and boiling point of 1091 degrees Celsius. So these two temperatures are well below the operating temperatures of ductile iron. So this is why magnesium is very violent, and loss in magnesium is going to be very high as and when we keep playing with the treatment temperatures. So this is why magnesium is volatile, loss in magnesium is high because of these temperatures. So the entire target for a foundry will be retaining the maximum amount of magnesium, or reducing the loss in magnesium and getting the maximum amount of it with the available amount of magnesium. The chemical nature of magnesium is a potent nodulizer, the strongest nodulizer, and strong deoxidizing element, strong desulfurizing element. So that means readily magnesium forms magnesium oxide and magnesium sulfate, provided magnesium and oxygen and sulfur are available in adequate amounts. What is the role of magnesium as a nodulizer in ductile iron? Magnesium is the primary nodulizing element, as we had seen. Magnesium desulfurizes and deoxidizes the metal, because the cast iron base metal will generally contain oxygen and sulfur in different levels. Magnesium reacts with these elements, and it also reacts with silicon present in the metal and the silicon present in the alloy to form silicates. So these all compounds put together form substrate or the shell upon which the graphite starts precipitating and growing. So in addition to the compounds formed by magnesium, there are inoculating elements available which are being added as separately, like calcium, barium, strontium, cerium, and lanthanum. These form complex compounds along with the magnesium and along with the silicates or silicon and oxygen present in the metal. So these form shell over the substrate over the shell. So in the presentation, we'll be discussing about what is a shell, what is a substrate, and why do we need all these things. So with all these compounds and all these formations, graphite precipitates and starts growing into spheres, producing good ductile iron instead of producing flake iron, which is a poor nodularity or a poor ductile iron. So this is a silicate theory, which talks about which is a proposal about a nucleation mechanism which is happening in ductile iron. So we have liquid metal with oxygen and sulfur in the desired amount, and we have got nodulizer, a light master alloy with magnesium, rare earths, calcium, aluminium, and silicon. And we do inoculation either along with the treatment or post treatment during the transfer with either calcium, barium, or combination of these elements. So when we do all this process, what happens in the liquid metal is there is a pore being formed when magnesium reacts with sulfur and forms magnesium sulfate or calcium sulfate. So these are some compounds which form the core of the nuclei. So when we consider this hexagon as a nuclei, so this calcium sulfate and magnesium sulfate forms the core, upon which the magnesium product like Mg forms MgO, and this MgO reacts with silica in the liquid metal formed either by the alloy or from the liquid metal by itself to form magnesium silicate like monosilicate or disilicate, and these form a shell over the core. So there can be a question that why should we need a substrate or why should we need an inoculation when we already do a depth alliance treatment? Because in castine there is only one kind of treatment or addition, which is just inoculation. And in ductalin, why do we need two types of metal additions or treatments? See, because this core and shell has got an incompatibility issue with the graphite which is precipitating. Graphite which is precipitating will generally be in HCP crystal structure, and it is going to be adherence of different lattices. So for two different materials to adhere to itself, so it should have a similar crystallographic structure such that it it becomes favorable for the graphite to precipitate by itself and then grow by itself. So if there is a misfit or incompatibility, then it will not be, the shell or the core will not become a favorable platform where the graphite can precipitate. So if it is unfavorable, then graphite will find it difficult to precipitate, and then if it doesn't precipitate, it becomes combined carbon, and then you start losing graphite. So this is why magnesium silicates or this MgS or CaS doesn't provide the enough substrate. So this is the place where the inoculating elements come into picture. So inoculating elements form oxides or oxysulfates or silicates which sit over this shell, and then this substrate has got a good compatibility with the precipitating carbon. So these two put together form the nuclei upon which the graphite is precipitating. So over this, the entire graphite growth starts happening. So the first carbon deposits over the substrate, and then subsequent carbon keeps depositing over on the other, and the graphite growth starts happening. So this is why we need an inoculant, and magnesium treatment alone is not sufficient to produce good ductalin. So effect of residual magnesium in ductalin. So what is the term residual magnesium called? Why is it called residual magnesium? So as we know, magnesium is a volatile element, and then it starts losing its potency or gets boiled off during the treatment process or the pouring process. So there is only some magnesium left over after the loss during the production. So people are quantifying that as residual magnesium, and then residual magnesium determines the quality of ductalin finally to some extent. So residual magnesium is dependent on or to be targeted based on the section thickness of the castings. So as the section thickness keeps increasing, the cooling rate becomes slower. As the cooling rate becomes very slow, there is a tendency that the graphite nodularity can become poor. So for thick section castings, you need to have a comparatively higher residual magnesium. High in the sense it is not too high, it can be in the range of say 0.4 to 0.5. Comparatively higher than a thin section casting. And there is a catch. As we keep increasing residual magnesium beyond an extent which is not desired, what will happen is you start getting inverse garbage, you start getting chunky graphite, and then you have got exploded graphite issues coming up. So the same way, as we go down or as we go towards the thinner section of the casting where there is an adequate cooling rate to produce good ductile ion, good nodules, so there you don't need a require a high residual magnesium. So the residual magnesium requirement and the magnesium alloy or the magnesium content in the alloy can be selected based on the casting specific rather than for a foundry specific. So a foundry can have a variety of casting like a thin section or an average section casting. So the alloy selection or the addition rate selection or residual magnesium targets should be varying for different castings rather than for a common foundry say telling my entire foundry would require 0.35 to 0.45. No, it doesn't work in that way, because there are worst conditions where you need more residual magnesium. You cannot employ or apply the same concept for a normal castings where you don't want high residual magnesium, because high residual magnesium is also dangerous. So how do we qualify or quantify the residual magnesium or the magnesium required calculation? So if we are going to quantify the residual magnesium as the criteria, then we should be having a calculation. So the recovery calculation is as simple as that. You have final minus initial divided by initial into 100. So upon this, we add some additional factor called sulfurize, like a factor which or factor which includes the amount of magnesium getting consumed by sulfur. As we know, magnesium is a desulfurizing element. So magnesium combines with sulfur to form magnesium sulfide. So that stoichiometry is taken into account. That means the amount of magnesium getting consumed by sulfur plus the amount of resident magnesium available. So what the spectrometers generally show us is the total magnesium available to some extent. So that means some of magnesium is already lost, and that is being quantified with the sulfur addition plus the residual magnesium. So the formula one, the first formula is a plain simple magnesium and sulfur related formula. That formula doesn't take any account of the process parameters or process variations like the amount of metal varying, the tapping temperature variation, the time taken to empty the ladle after treatment, or the holding time after treatment. It doesn't come into picture. So there is an elaborate formula which talks about the liquid metal weight, which talks about the temperature, which talks about the time taken to empty the ladle is given by Soral Metal. It's an extended formula. And if a foundry really needs to work upon controlling their residual magnesium or the magnesium recovery, then they should be not just looking at the magnesium content in the alloy, rather they should also be controlling the other parameters which influence the residual magnesium or magnesium recovery. This way, if foundry is able to have a control over the other elements, then formula one can be used. Or if the foundry is yet to start controlling the parameters, then formula two to be used. And after stabilizing everything, they can just go back to the formula one, just calculating the magnesium and sulfur, provided all the other parameters are under control or the variations are less. So this is the effect of holding time after treatment. What happens to our residual magnesium is residual magnesium keeps decreasing. This is what we call as fading. Fading means the loss in potency of the property. So residual magnesium keeps decreasing, and the same way proportionally the nodularity for the same section thickness and the same casting keeps decreasing with respect to time. So this way the adequate amount of holding time to be arrived, or holding time rather than the pouring time to be arrived at, foundry to foundry, casting to casting, section thickness to section thickness, based on the foundry conditions and the losses happening during treatment and pouring. So these are some of the factors we'll be discussing about magnesium recovery influencing treatment temperature, the temperature at which the treatment happens, because as we know, magnesium is a volatile element and the operating temperatures are very higher than the boiling point of magnesium. So when the treatment temperature varies or increases, the loss in magnesium increases because of oxidation, because of boiling. When the ladle design varies, say for example, when you expose the ladle, when you expose the metal to atmosphere for a longer time, then you start losing magnesium, or there can be a loss because of oxygen pickup from the atmosphere, and then magnesium getting lost. So that way, ladle design and the cleanliness of the ladle has a major influence on the magnesium recovery for the same amount of alloy for the same addition rate. And the base chemistry, when we have trap elements or when we have reactive elements in the liquid metal, these elements react with magnesium and then reduce the potency of the magnesium for becoming useful to sporidization. So this way, elements or base chemistry also have an impact on the magnesium and its usefulness. Then the pouring time. So as we have seen in the previous slides, like the fading time or the magnesium fading increases with respect to time. So we should optimally arrive at a pouring time for the particular casting to arrive at the optimum microstructure to be achieved for the given time. So the pouring time to be achieved at for casting specific and for the alloy specific or the process parameter specific. Longer pouring time also will lead to temperature loss, and when the temperature loss becomes more, and then the severity of magnesium loss varies exponentially. And the additions to ladle. So the packing or the tight packing of the alloy to the magnesium ladle, or making the magnesium or alloy getting exposed to the liquid metal faster, or will also have an influence of magnesium getting lost during the treatment and the treatment process by itself. So when the rate of tapping, the amount at which the liquid metal is being filled into the ladle, and the height for a given, or at any given instance, the amount of liquid metal height maintained over the alloy chamber decides the efficiency of a treatment. So it is decided that more amount of liquid metal should be present over the alloy to ensure that magnesium vapors doesn't go off and magnesium vapor is retained inside the liquid metal. And there is a catch also, because there is no mixing happening, manual mixing happening in the ladle. So the magnesium should by itself influx and then mix by itself. So it is better to have the maximum amount of liquid metal over the magnesium alloy, and as and when the dissolution happens in the liquid metal, magnesium vapors keep moving from bottom to top, and then it is stopped by the liquid metal available and it gets mixed by itself. So these are some other parameters which influence the recovery and addition of magnesium. Sulfur content in the base metal, oxygen which is measurable, oxygen content in the base metal which is very difficult to measure at the conventional foundry stages, and there are measures available, indirect measures available for oxygen content like thermal analysis, slag from the furnace, because generally slags are oxides in nature. I mean, these slags get into the treatment ladle, so when the magnesium comes in contact with the slag in the liquid metal, it starts generating magnesium oxides, which way we'll be losing magnesium. Tapping temperature, as we have seen, tapping temperature has a direct influence on the magnesium recovery. And if magnesium recovery is varying, then the amount of magnesium required in our alloy and the addition rate keeps varying. So this way, the time, the other parameters like the time of FeSM, that's the alloy addition to the ladle. So ladle will be hot as it is going to be in a production scenario. And when we keep adding the alloy very early before tapping, so the alloy gets preheated and the dissolution can become faster, because it will reach the melting point faster than the normal condition. So alloy to be added to the pocket or to the ladle just before tapping, very closer with the minimum time available. Slag in the ladle and pocket. So this talks about the cleanliness of the ladle. This can be two ways. One, it reduces the useful volume of the pocket or ladle. Two, the slag when it comes in contact with the magnesium can generate magnesium oxide or magnesium sulfate, this way losing magnesium. And the cover for FeSAMG alloy, this is to reduce or delay the reaction happening. So as we delay the reaction happening, the recovery keeps increasing, because you will be having more amount of metal available on top, so magnesium vapor doesn't go out or escape the liquid metal, and you will be retaining the maximum magnesium inside the liquid metal. So you'll be getting the maximum benefit out of the amount of magnesium being added to the liquid metal. So the filling time of the ladle, as we had seen, the intermittent filling will have direct effect. The pouring time has got a direct effect on the magnesium recovery. The ladle design, the composition of the nodulizer. So people tend to keep very high magnesium to compensate all the variations coming up in the process, in their process. That is not the direct or right method, because there are conditions where your foundry conditions are going to be normal or even good. Such conditions does not require any high addition rates or high magnesium content alloy. So alloy selection and the amount of magnesium in the alloy is to be selected based on the process variations, and process variations which is in our hand, which can be controlled, should be controlled accordingly. And the alloy sizing, so the size distribution of the alloy also has a direct impact on the dissolution of the ferrosilicon magnesium or the alloy. And as the dissolution is being influenced by sizing, the dissolution is a factor where the liberation of magnesium into the liquid metal is going to be determined. So alloy sizing or size distribution has a direct impact, which we will be discussing in this presentation. Storage of foundry alloys, these materials when exposed to moisture pick up some moisture. They are not highly hygroscopic, but they do pick up some moisture, and moist material when added to liquid metal will lead to a catastrophe. Or this moisture contains water, which when becomes steam, is a strong oxidizing agent. It reacts with magnesium to form all kind of compounds which are not desired. So based on different process variables, and this is the chart, it's a general guideline upon which the magnesium alloy can be selected. Like there are different types of magnesium alloys available: low magnesium, medium magnesium, and high magnesium. And there are supplementary elements like calcium and rare earth contents, which are being selected based on the process parameters in the foundry. And when we see this entire table, we can understand that most number of ticks are available in alloy content, where you have a medium magnesium content 6 to 8%, medium calcium content 1 to 2%, and medium rare earth content 1 to 2%. So this particular combination of alloy will be able to suit to the maximum recovery of a foundry. So it is not just the magnesium content which is going to support in your good ductile iron production. It is the other elements which is going to complement the magnesium. to produce good ductile iron. So it is not always required that you have to keep increasing magnesium or you have to keep adding more magnesium to get good ductile iron. You can always have the supplementary elements being increased to compensate magnesium with the same amount of magnesium available. That means you need not increase 6 to 8 to 8 to 10. You can still increase calcium or rare earth content and still retain 68% magnesium to get the maximum benefit of it. So these are some of the reasons or assumptions what people do while selecting or for selecting high magnesium. So they think that the addition rates can be reduced. Yes, because we are trying to increase the magnesium content and we are compensating for the loss in magnesium by increasing the magnesium content. This way, by numbers, the treatment cost can be reduced, but it has got every magnesium increase has got its own negative advantages. That means disadvantages. People select this kind of shortcuts or these methods to compensate the variations at their end. The following are some of the variations which generally happen in foundries, like varying sulfur levels, varying tapping temperatures, varying pouring time, because they might be having different foundries, different pouring lines where they have a shorter pouring time, not a longer pouring time, and excess sulfur content in the mold, because the molding systems can be different or the mold additives can be varying based on the casting section thicknesses and the casting bunch weights. So, and when there is going to be a deterioration coming from the mold and they expect that the ferrosilicon magnesium being added should take care of everything. So it is going to be the alloy which is going to take care. It is not just the magnesium content. So the supplementary elements, as we had discussed previously, like calcium and rare earths can be added according to the requirement such that magnesium amount need not be increased. So what should be the target of an efficient foundry is to achieve the desired microstructure throughout the casting at an optimum magnesium addition with the maximum recovery or the maximum yield from the treatment process. That means I should be always aiming at 90% nodality and I should not be aiming at residual magnesium. So if I want to aim at residual magnesium, I should be aiming at residual magnesium at the lowest magnesium content alloy addition. So such that I can increase or optimize my supplementary elements such that I can still retain my magnesium content, because as magnesium content keeps increasing, magnesium is dangerous. So now we'll be discussing about what happens or what influences or how the size distribution of the alloy influences the magnesium recovery. So it is generally classified as finer size distribution, coarser size distribution, and a wider size distribution, or finer size and wider size are closely comparable to each other. And why do we need to have a wider size distribution is, when we have a wider size distribution, or sorry, the factors which influence the selecting the size distribution would be generally the amount of liquid metal being treated, like the quantity of metal, the metal weight or metal volume, the treatment ladle capacity. So say for example, I have a 1-ton treatment ladle and I do a 750 kg treatment, or I have got a 1-ton treatment ladle, I do a 500 kg treatment. So my size distribution selection varies, and the reaction violence during the treatment. So when all these three things are varying, selection of the size distribution to be done accordingly, which in turn helps you in getting the maximum benefit or maximum recovery from the available magnesium without increasing the magnesium alloy, magnesium content in the alloy, sorry. So it's just a comparison between a wider size distribution and a narrow size distribution. So wider size distribution gives you a more compaction and then highly dense packing at the treatment pocket area, where the narrow size distribution does not provide it. It provides loose compaction and then loose packing. So what is the advantage of having a compacted packing and non-compacted packing is the ductile iron percolates into the voids available during packing and then starts dissolving the material. So question might come that if I have a finer size material, the surface area is bigger, so it can dissolve faster. Why will it not affect my recovery? So what happens in a compacted packing is, the first material, so first the ductile iron finds it difficult, liquid metal finds it difficult to percolate into the compacted or packed alloy. And even if it percolates into, the first material will be dissolving, will be the finer size material, and then the coarser size material starts dissolving. And as and when this finer size material starts dissolving, it increases the viscosity of the material, because this is ferrosilicon alloys. So locally, the viscosity of the metal keeps increasing. When the viscosity of the metal keeps increasing, the fluidity comes down and the percolating capacity comes down. So this way, you are in total put together, you are trying to reduce the flowability of metal and then letting the reaction happen or dissolution happen slowly. So my reaction is delayed, my dissolution is delayed. So the delay is because our delay is expected because I have to keep filling. I'm keeping the ladle being filled continuously and tapping continuously such that I'm expecting that the magnesium reaction should happen only after I fill my treatment ladle. So this way, this compacted packing will help achieving the delayed reaction by itself. And narrow size distribution does not aid it because you let the liquid metal pass through into the material by itself and then it start dissolving. So what happens when it readily goes into the liquid metal and start into the packing and dissolving is when you let more liquid metal into it, and we know that these materials have got a lesser density than liquid iron. So when the liquid metal enters with a higher velocity into the void, it starts lifting the material. So this way, the coarser material starts floating, might float as and when you keep increasing the voids or you have a lesser packing of the material. So there is a misconception that wider size distribution means finer size material only. No, wider size distribution talks about a wide range of distribution. Say for example, there is a material distribution from 4 mm to 35 mm. That means it will have 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. So it has got a varying distribution in a adequate amount such that your packing density is increased, your percolation is decreased, your reaction violence is decreased, and then your reaction is delayed. So this is a typical packing density calculation considering this jar or measuring jar as a pocket of your treatment ladle, and we have done a packing wider size distribution and narrow size distribution material, and we have calculated the packing density by the volume fraction method. And what we have found is for the same weight of material, packing density or the bulk density is more with the finer size distribution or the wider size distribution rather than a narrower size distribution. So a wider size distribution gives you an increased packing density or bulk density compared to a coarser size distribution. So this way, the losses due to burning of magnesium is reduced, the reaction violence is reduced, the consumption of magnesium alloy is reduced, or you can get the maximum benefit out of the same alloy content with the same addition rate with the same magnesium content in the alloy, because your reaction is subdued, your reaction is delayed. So how do you select a suitable size distribution for your process is for quantities up to 1000 kg treatment, 2 to 20 mm or 2 to 25 mm, the wider size distribution can be adopted. Or as the metal weight keeps increasing over a ton or 1000 kg, the coarser size material can be adopted because of the amount of metal getting entered, amount of metal entering the treatment ladle and the tapping rate at which the metal is being filled. So the velocities keep increasing as we keep increasing the liquid metal, and because we'll be filling at a faster flow rate. So when we have a higher quantity, we can go for a wider size distribution or a coarser material distribution rather a finer distribution. And the reaction violence, when we compare the reaction violence, the coarser size material is generally more exposed, less packing factor, and early recovery early reaction happens. Very finer size, like means very narrow size distribution, and towards the finer size, it can lift and the material can be lighter, it will lift and then float and then reduce the recovery. So if we have a wider size distribution which incorporates a different size system where you have got a finer material as well as a coarser material, this packing will give you a high packing factor or a good packing, and then a delayed reaction and the improved recovery for the same alloy and the same magnesium content. So what would be an ideal suggestion to any nodulizer or selection of a nodulizer to a foundry would be 6 to 8% magnesium, 1 to 2% rare earth, 1 to 2% calcium is the most advisable and safe treatment alloy for producing various casting section thicknesses with varying foundry conditions, where the magnesium content need not vary anything above 6 to 8, and any process variations can be countered by using a different alloy, or variations can be done in the treatment or supplementary elements like calcium and then rare earth. Nodulizer size, a wider size distribution will always help you in getting the maximum magnesium recovery for the given magnesium content or for the given alloy. So with this, we come to the end of the presentation. What do we understand from this presentation? What do we take away from this presentation is, we have gone through the different types of nodulizers available. We have gone through the role of magnesium as nodulizing element. We have gone through the effect of residual magnesium and how much to be maintained to what type of castings, and then the different magnesium recovery calculations, which will be useful, handy for the people to calculate the efficiency of a treatment alloy and the process. We have discussed about the nodulases effect, nodulases magnesium percentage effect of it in the ductile ion, and we have discussed about the distribution of size distribution of the nodulizer and its effect over residual magnesium and recovery in ductile ion treatment. So the ultimate aim for a foundry, as we had seen previously, is that we optimize, have an optimized addition rate of a magnesium alloy, and to compensate or to make compensation for any of the foundry process variables, magnesium is not the only tool available. Or say, for example, I keep getting issues, instead of 6 to 8%, I increase my magnesium to 8 to 10%, so I'll be actually adding more magnesium to compensate for my loss. But actually, we should be working about understanding the loss happening in the foundry and arresting the root cause for the loss. So it can be the process variation by itself, it can be the metal weight, it can be the tapping temperature variation, or it can be the other process parameters which is influencing 6 to 8% magnesium grade. So for a switchover of 6 to 8 to become 8 to 8-10%. So magnesium is a dangerous element, and when added beyond desired limit. So care to be taken such that we go to, as we are working towards greener foundry, safer environment for the people to work and for the society. So let us produce a safer, cleaner, good ductile ion with the optimum minimum magnesium content available and maximizing its potency and capacity. I thank you all for giving this opportunity, and we are happy and privileged to meet the foundry fraternity and foundry industry and share our knowledges through the opportunity provided by Dynamic Foundry Group. Thank you once again from SNAM Alloys, on behalf of SNAM Alloys. Thank you all. Have a great year ahead.